ったんです。
I'm your host, Karen Dolan, coming to you live from Rochester, New York, via the Paranormal Radio Network, and also on UPRN 105.5 FM New Orleans. For more information on the show and on my guests, visit our website at www.keyholepublishing.com. And thanks for joining me this evening. As always, I want to hear from you. If you're listening live tonight, join us on the message board to discuss the program and add your questions and comments. Go to ParanormalRadioNetwork.com to join us in the virtual auditorium, and you can participate in the conversation there through instant messaging. You can also email me with your questions and comments anytime at kdolan@rochester.rr.com. You can also call into the show toll-free at 1-877-786-0562. And if you missed any of that, it's all on the webpage at www.keyholepublishing.com. Well, it's mid-October now, and Halloween will be here soon. This is the time of year when many people say that paranormal activity increases and the veil between the worlds is thin. If you listen regularly to Through the Keyhole, you may have noticed the last few weeks that I've kind of moved away from discussion of UFOs, and I've been focusing instead on stories of ghosts and monsters. I've been speaking with paranormal investigators, ghost hunters, cryptozoologists, and people who write about their experiences. My guest this evening is a woman who is well known for her paranormal investigations and for her more than 40 books on the subject. She says on her website that her driving purpose is to help further our understanding of our place and role in the cosmic scheme, to open our minds to more aspects of reality than that which is readily visible. She says our daily life is only a slice of a multidimensional universe. And I think that's a very elegant way of stating a cosmic truth. Please join me this evening in welcoming Rosemary Ellen Guiley to Through the Keyhole. Rosemary, I've been wanting to talk to you on the show for ages. I'm so glad you're finally here.
It's so great to connect, Karen.
One thing I noticed on your website is you mentioned that your interest in these subjects was stimulated early in life by precognitive dreaming in your family. But there was just that statement. Can you tell me more about that?
Sure. I think a lot of us who get deeply involved in the paranormal have had some sort of remarkable experience, often early in life, that gets us going. And a lot of children, I had unusual experiences that were paranormal in nature. Of course, when you're a little kid, you don't think of them as paranormal, like seeing things like invisible playmates or beings like angels. I had angels who, you know, came and sang to me when I went to sleep, you know, things like that. But one of the things that really piqued my interest was precognitive dreaming. Now, different members of my family had varying kinds of psychic experiences and abilities, and my mother had a lot of precognitive dreams. I was in my adolescence when she shared a lot of these dreams with me, and they were very troubling, of course, because they often involved disasters and death and you know, scary things like that, things that were very emotionally upsetting. Well, I was fascinated. I was already hooked on sci-fi, fantasy, astronomy, horror, paranormal, the occult, the supernatural, and the idea that you could dream the future and that future would come to pass really gripped my attention. I wanted to know more about that. I was also, by that time in life, understanding that people have a variety of psychic experiences, and not everybody experiences the same thing. And some of my experiences weren't necessarily shared by others, even if they were with me at the time. So I started doing research on dreams and on extrasensory perception, and putting together my own experiments. I was in my teens by the time I started doing a lot of that. I wanted to see if I could see the future in dreams, program myself to see the future. Could I do astral projection traveling in dreams? Could I send messages to people in dreams? Could I get messages? And I discovered that the answer was yes to all of those things.
Wow.
I it was, you know, never 100%. We never get 100% results with things like this, but I certainly had enough good in the way of good results that I knew that there was something there, that these were real experiences. And, you know, that was kind of the pickle out of the jar there, and one thing led to another, and here I am 42 books later.
Well, at what age were you starting to do all of these things? I mean, this just sounds so amazing that the way you talk about it sounds as if you were a child at the time, and the kind of things you're talking about doing, I think very few children are even aware of, much less actively practicing.
Right. Now, some of the experiences I had when I was small, you know, like I said, at the time, a kid doesn't think that they're having paranormal experiences. It was much later on, in looking back over those experiences with more knowledge about the paranormal, and also the fact that most children seem to have at least one or two, if not a number of paranormal experiences, I was able to put those into that sort of context. I was in my tweens when I learned about my mom's experiences, you know, 11, 12 years old. Mm-hmm. She shared some of the dreams with me, and I was fascinated by that, and she wanted the dreams to go away. Now, it wasn't until I was, around 15, 16, that I started doing a lot of active experimenting on my own. I discovered a book by Harold Sherman that's a classic today. You know, he did Thoughts Through Space. He also did a book on how to experiment with ESP.
Oh.
And it was through a lot of Harold Sherman's work that I learned more about dreams, because he had done the same sort of thing. He had done experiments to send messages to people, and he especially had worked with his daughter. You know, I was in high school when I was doing a lot of this, and it was just for my own personal interest. I have never had the kind of precognitive dreams that my mother did. She had dreams usually of people dying. Sometimes she knew them personally. Sometimes they were things, you know, they were big things that happened in the media. You know, she would learn about it through the media. My sister also has some degree of psychic ability, but she never had precognitive dreams like my mom either. She had other kinds of experiences, and I had different kinds of experiences. So we all had some sort of psychic faculty going, but it manifested in different ways. But for me, dreams, I could see very early in life that dreams were an important doorway to extraordinary experience. And the more I read about dreams and understood what ancient cultures had to say about them from that very perspective, I developed a deeper appreciation for what we're capable of experiencing when we're in that state of consciousness. And I've done 6 books on dreams, and they've all been from the perspective of the big dream, the paranormal dreams, the life-changing dreams, dream programming for improving our healing and creativity powers, you know, that sort of thing. I think it's very important to pay attention to our dreams.
So how can someone tell when they have an unusual dream? How can we tell if it's just, gosh, I shouldn't have had the peppers on that pizza that night, or, you know, if it's something that you really should pay attention to?
You just have to put in a little elbow work and learn how your dreams are speaking to you. There is a difference between what we would call ordinary dreaming, which is about stuff going on in life. And the bulk of our dreams really is about how we feel we're doing in life, our emotional equilibrium. The extraordinary dreams have their own unique signatures. Now, there's some general characteristics that apply to a lot of extraordinary dreaming, but the only way that you're going to know for sure how such a dream stands out is to learn your own dream language. And it doesn't take a lot of effort to understand that language. You can pay attention to your dreams, think about them, do some dream work, you know, interpreting their meanings. Extraordinary dreams, some of the general characteristics are there's often a feeling of heaviness in them, like the atmosphere is extremely heavy, almost like you're underwater. Colors may be unusually sharp, different, brilliant, maybe fluorescent. There may be lucidity in the dream, that is, knowing you're dreaming while you're having the dream. For many people, there are certain cues in a dream, certain symbols or emotional feelings. Precognitive dreams about bad things happening, impending disasters or deaths of someone important or close to you, are often accompanied by extreme emotions in dreams, maybe even physical discomfort or nausea that continues into the waking state. There are certain symbols that are unique to the dreamer, wouldn't apply to another person, but applies to you. And I can give you some examples from my mother's pattern. Because every dream of a death or disaster does not mean it's a forecast of something that's actually going to happen. They can be symbolic in terms of saying something about what's going on within us. So the first approach that people have to make in looking at dreams are, what is the dream saying about me? Is this an ordinary dream? And if I can't quite fit it into that category, then I should look at something extraordinary or precognitive. Well, in my mother's case, she often experienced physical discomfort. For her, this was usually nausea. She felt nauseated in the dream and nauseated when she woke up. Mm-hmm. If her own dead mother was in the dream as well, that was often a cue to her that this was a precognitive dream. And the precognitive dreams were also filled with unusually vivid imagery and a sense of foreboding. Now, all of those things can exist in ordinary dreaming. So it's only by practice and getting a handle on our dreams that we can learn to distinguish the ordinary from the extraordinary.
I was interested when you mentioned your own personal dream language, you know, that each person needs to pay attention to their own dreams. So when we go to bookstores and we see all those thousands of books about interpreting dreams, and they have lists of things like, well, if you dream of a cat, it means this, and if you dream of a mountain, it means that. That always seemed odd to me, like it couldn't possibly work that way. And it sounds like what you're saying kind of goes along with this, that the same symbols might turn up in two different people's dreams, and they could mean very different things.
That's very true, Karen, and I do have to admit, I have done a dream dictionary. It's in my first book on dreams called The Encyclopedia of Dreams. But here's how I approach that, and because I've done lay dream work as a facilitator for a good number of years, and people need starting points, especially when they're beginners in dream work. And dictionaries are wonderful starting points, but they're not the end point and they're not the definitive answer. There are certain themes and symbols that have an almost universal application, that in most cases that's going to have a particular meaning. But our dreams are filtered through our worldviews, our personal upbringings, our emotions at the time. So we're always going to give kind of a unique slant to things. So I tell people that dictionaries can be very good at starting points, but what they should initiate is a process, an intuitive process of free association that gives you ideas for what to bounce onto that's going to hit the mark. Sometimes a dictionary meaning will hit the mark for people. When I do dream work with people, and sometimes I do it on the radio, and if people give me a short dream, and my answer will be, if this were my dream, this is how I would look at it. And so take that information and see what resonates with you and what doesn't, and only you, the dreamer, is going to be able ultimately to interpret a dream. But some of the universal symbols are, mother and father. Those have archetypal associations for our own capability as a mother or a father. or a need for mothering or fathering.
I was just about to ask about the archetypes because we're talking about symbols, and certain symbols mean different things to different people, but there are others that are constant, and that just made me think of certain archetypes are going to turn up in anybody's dreams, really.
So, exactly, and then you can look at them as different layers. For example, let's say you have a dream with a mother figure in it, or your own mother. Well, when we dream of our parents, we're often dreaming about our parents in terms of our relationship with them rather than something going on within us. But you can look at it archetypally, like what does mother mean to you in the biggest sense of the word? What are your personal feelings about mother? What's the context of the dream that it's speaking in? And you're going to be bringing to that dream your entire relationship with your own mother, or perhaps your own concept of yourself as a mother. So there are lots of different avenues to shoot off from, but sometimes you need this starting point that gets you going. Now, I do have to caution people about some dream dictionaries that they don't quite seem to hit the mark for us. And it's not that there's anything faulty in the books themselves. It's the culture they come from, because our dreams use language, plays on words, puns, social contexts of the time, idioms, and things like that to convey symbolic meanings to us. And some of the dream dictionaries out there are very old books, which have been around for centuries, were written in other languages besides ours. And when things are translated into our own language, that's where the meaning gets lost, because it meant something in a different context in time and language.
That makes a lot of sense. You know, and when you were talking about this, especially in terms of motherhood, I know when I had small children, when my kids were very little, I used to have dreams involving water all the time, and it took me a while, but I realized that water represented motherhood in my dreams.
Mm-hmm.
That always meant that for me. And so when I had a dream about, you know, falling into water, I thought, oh, that was a day when I was feeling a little overwhelmed by the whole mom thing. And I actually had a dream once about a friend of mine, that I was visiting her, and we were looking out this big picture window at the ocean, and we saw this huge wave coming up. And it was about to sort of engulf her house, and I helped her get her kids out of the house. And I realized later I needed to call her because I was worried about her feeling overwhelmed.
Mm-hmm.
And she was. You know, she was having a tough week. And it was just so funny that, you know, I've really learned to pick up that cue. Now, on the other hand, I have a friend who told me one day he had the oddest dream about a fire in his mother's basement. And he couldn't think what that was. And I said, well, you're worried about your dad. And he said, what? Well, his dad does a lot of electronics work and had like a workshop in the basement of the house that he grew up in. And I said, you're thinking about an electrical fire. You're thinking about all this electronic stuff that your dad likes to do. You're worried about him. I said, give him a call. See how he's doing. And it turned out his dad was ill. And, you know, he really was happy to hear from his son that day. So it's just funny how, like, water meant mother and fire mother in that case.
And everybody's going to bring their own unique twist to a lot of these symbols based on the context of what's going on in our lives and what makes sense to us. Dreaming is highly intuitive. You're really calling on your gut feelings when you're dealing with dreams. They're really mirrors of truth, and this is what I've always told people, that dreams are mirrors of truth. And they reflect honest feelings to us, our fears, our anxieties, our worries, our hopes, our ambitions. They really help us keep in balance. And when you get to the truth of a dream, there's an aha feeling that you can't deny. You just know you've hit the mark. And dream work in a group is very valuable for learning that too, because if other people contribute information, like if this were my dream, I would consider this, that fuels the intuitive process. The dreamer may come up with something, you know, entirely independent, but the ideas of others can spark that process.
That sounds like such a great way to learn about this.
Well, you know, getting back to the paranormal connection, Karen, so many of our experiences happen in a dream state.
Mm-hmm.
When we're dreaming, our consciousness is unbounded by space and time, and by the feeling of being in the body. And even Plato called dreams the between state. He said this is the place where you go and meet the gods. And when you think about all of our experiences that we have with the paranormal, how many of them come in dreams, psychic experiences, precognition, meetings with the dead, encounters with gods and goddesses, with aliens, the abduction experiences, mystical experiences, miraculous healings, meetings with religious figures, near-death experiences can have a dreamlike quality to them. So many of our extraordinary experiences that penetrate into these other slices of the multiverse are powered by dreaming consciousness.
It's interesting that you mentioned encounters with aliens and the abduction experience. There's a big controversy about that people like, I believe it's Susan Clancy, always wants to say that the abduction experience is just sleep paralysis. And a lot of people who've had the experience have said, well, I wasn't asleep when it happened. So how do you explain that? As I say, I wasn't even in bed. It wasn't at night. I was driving my car in the middle of the afternoon or something like that. But I see your point, because a lot of these things do result in a sort of change of consciousness.
They do, and people do go into like an altered state. I think that doorways open up between dimensions, that these experiences are portal experiences where two realms intersect or blend into each other, and they're varying altered states of consciousness. And some of these experiences do happen when we're dreaming or sleeping, or we're not quite, it seems like a dream, but we feel we're awake. That's another kind of unusual state that a lot of these experiences happen in. And I've heard the same skeptical argument applied to paranormal experiences like the nightmare hag, the hag attacks at night, incubus, succubus attacks, even bedside visitations from the dead, that because quite often, if you think that you wake up, or you're not sure if you're asleep or dreaming, which is often the case in these experiences, but you feel that you're paralyzed in bed. And to dismiss all these experiences as a physiological state of sleep paralysis, maybe we can explain a tiny amount of them that way, but certainly not all of them. I have always felt that people have genuine experiences, and my interest in the paranormal has always been the how and the why. Clearly we're experiencing something. What is it? How does it happen, and why is it happening?
Yeah, even, Bud Hopkins said, okay, if these are all sleep paralysis, and I'm not admitting any of that because that totally discounts all of the physical evidence, the marks people find on their bodies when they get up the next morning. But even agreeing that maybe a large percentage of them are sleep paralysis, he always said, so what's the phenomenon that's causing all of these people to perceive the same experience? Why are they all seeing the same things? Where are the images coming from?
And he's exactly right. I've done so many different topics on the paranormal, and I look at things like history, mythology, folklore, sociology, spiritual traditions, etc. I cast a wide net, and it's very clear to me that human beings have had what I call core experiences, core extraordinary experiences throughout our history, where we're encountering something, we're engaging with something. And sometimes our descriptions and labels differ according to time and history, context, you know, things like that. In other words, how we can explain things according to our worldview. But the core elements of the experiences remain fairly consistent. So the question is, right, what is behind all of that? And why is it happening? And where is it all going? For the past 5 years, I've been doing a lot of research into shadow people. And people have, I got interested because, you know, people start asking me questions. You know, I get email from people and say, what is this experience? And I started noticing that I was getting a lot of inquiries about certain types of bedside visitations. Dark figures, usually, you know, 6 to 7 feet tall, seemingly male, often wearing coats and hats, and radiating this incredible malevolence. Coming through walls, vanishing, you know, acting a lot like people say abducting ETs do. But in researching them, I felt that they weren't ghosts. They're not demons, even though they radiate malevolence. They didn't seem to be ETs, but yet they seem to share a lot of characteristics with those kinds of experiences.
They kind of remind me of the Men in Black, who are associated with the ET experience.
Absolutely. In fact, there is a connection with ET experience. The more I got into them, I found that a lot of the shadow people experiencers are also ET experiencers.
Hmm.
And I began to wonder, what's the purpose of these entities for engaging with us? Well, they like to visit us at night while we're sleeping. You can't see any eyes in them, but they seem to penetrate you with a stare. And I've seen these entities, and they do. They have a deeply piercing stare. Even though you're not seeing any eyes, it's very strange. And I began to wonder if they were like probing our consciousness for some sort of information. Were these things like artificial intelligence? Were they scouts, drones, assistants, ultra-terrestrials co-opted into some bigger agenda? All of these questions started coming up around this phenomenon. And I don't have any definitive answers yet, but I do think that there's a link between the abduction experience and the shadow person experience. It may be that the shadow people are gathering data about human beings that's easier for them to pick out from us when we sleep. That may be useful in something like when applied into an abduction experience. They may be getting information about how we literally anchor ourselves in physical reality. One of the new projects that I'm doing now, which I'm quite excited about, it's a book where we are looking for like explanations behind the scenes here. For several years, I've been doing a variety of research projects with Phil Imbrogno, and we are doing a book now on the djinn, which will be out next year. And you can apply the djinn to paranormal and UFO phenomena very nicely in terms of the presence or the entity behind the masks. And djinn in Middle Eastern folklore, they're not quite demons. They're often called demons. But they're a race. They're a race of beings, very powerful. They once occupied this earth. And according to mythology, they were pushed out for humans. And some of them have the idea that they'd like the earth back, but they exist in another dimension. They don't anchor very well in this one. So here's a question to explore then. Would shadow people be a manifestation of djinn? They come to us at night looking for information on how do they travel into this world and stay in this world.
Is it possible, too, that in addition to collecting information about us, that they might be putting anything in our minds, that they might be projecting images or information to us?
Definitely. I think that's certainly a possibility. And, you know, we find that in the abduction experience as well, where people feel that they're, you know, imparted some information. or given instructions for doing things. And we find the same elements in other kinds of experiences as well. The encounter phenomenon is what the broad context is called, where people encounter some sort of alien presence and engage with them so that there is an extraction or an infusion of information. I had some experiences myself some years ago. This was back in the 1980s when I was really starting on my paranormal and spiritual work in earnest. And I say spiritual because all of this leads into spiritual matters and questions. If you start with ufology, if you start with the paranormal, you stay in it long enough and go deep enough, you wind up looking at the same spiritual questions that the mystics do. But I had these encounter experiences that they began in dreams. They were lucid dreams. And a female figure, at the time I identified her as an angel because she glowed, had no facial features, just kind of a glowy countenance on her face, kind of flowing robe-like suggestion of, you know, raiments of that sort. And in the dream, she would take me places. They were always in other realities, clearly not Earth. And I was given telepathic instruction. And the dreams were always quite pleasant. They seemed to happen whenever they needed to happen. I couldn't make them happen, in other words. And when I woke up, I knew that I had been given something, some information that was important to me, but I could not recall a lot of the specifics. And these dreams went on for a period of time. And then I had a bedside visit where I received an infusion, a very dramatic infusion. We find descriptions of this throughout the literature of all kinds of experiences, mystical meetings with the gods, meeting with aliens, meetings with ascended masters. And this figure appeared at my bedside, and streams of energy came out of her hands and into me, like I was being downloaded, like a computer would be downloaded. And I've heard this kind of description in many of the experiences that people have shared with me of all kinds. And after I had this infusion, which I was paralyzed on the bed, I could not stop it. And I didn't know what was coming into me. I just felt like it was furiously fast bits of information.
Wow.
After that, I had no more instruction dreams. And I felt, in trying to understand it, I felt that something had been activated in me, like a blueprint. It was like an alchemical blueprint. The intentions that I came into this life with were energized, and that if I trusted the process of unfoldment, I would be guided in the right directions. And it really had to do with my work as an author in this area of examining all of these kinds of phenomena. And that's pretty much been the case over the years. I think that, you know, I'm really doing what I came into this life to do, and that I believe in reincarnation, and I think that the planning I made for this life was to engage in this kind of research. And I've had a variety of experiences along the way that have energized me, propelled me, you know, in the directions that were meaningful for my research. So I've come across many kinds of experiences that have the same, you know, what I'm getting at here is, you know, the same sorts of elements. They may not be exactly the same kind of experience, but we find the same elements. The meeting with a guide figure or a powerful being, an infusion of information, maybe even a giving of something. And something transformative happens as a result. Now, one of the things that Phil suggested to me when I shared this experience with him, it's going to be in one of the books that he has coming out next year. He wondered whether or not this figure was an ascended master, you know, a human being who had ascended and taken on the role of spiritual teacher. I could certainly see that now in retrospect, because when I asked this figure if she was an angel, her answer was, you do not understand who I am. I am not human. I am not angel. So I was wondering, you know, well, are you a hybrid or, you know, exactly what are you? But Ascended Master certainly makes a lot of sense. Ultimately, you know, people ask me, what did I experience? They share their experiences with me and then say, what was it that I encountered? And people really have to find their own truth about what makes sense. I've had the same kinds of experiences described to me that people feel were very much ET, that they encountered enlightened ETs who were coming to teach them and help them. We get back to that question of, well, we've got similar experiences here with different labels on them. What's behind the experience? And that's the truth that I'm trying to get at.
Wow. That raised several questions that I wanted to get into while you were talking, but I noticed there are a couple of questions on the message board. One person wants to know what you mean by an ascended master.
They come really out of the Eastern tradition, although we find them in the Western mystery tradition too. Traditionally, they are human beings who have achieved a highly enlightened state of consciousness, so that they pass out of the physical, and then they come back in a spiritualized form to impart spiritual teachings and enlightenment to other people. They act as spirit guides, but they were once human beings from Earth rather than from another part of the multiverse or, you know, even another planet.
So that's different from a bodhisattva, which, as I understand it, is a human who has evolved to the point where they could be a teacher such as that, but they choose to be reincarnated again into human form to teach. An ascended master would be someone who'd reached that level and teaches from a spiritual form rather than being incarnated again into a physical body. Is that right?
These boundaries get very blurry, and that's a word that I often use to describe things in the paranormal. It gets very difficult to say where one leaves off and the other starts, because I have read references to living people who are considered ascended masters, and that they are actually, have reincorporated themselves into a physical body again. But the most common description of them from a traditional point of view is that they're in a spiritualized form. They have shed the need for reincarnation in the physical. They probably could opt for it, but they're out of that karmic wheel, so to speak, of needing to come back into a body, but they choose to return to help other human beings achieve the same sort of state.
Okay.
A bodhisattva would be another term for the same sort of thing. You know, an enlightened human being who teaches other people, and also is etherealized in many ways, you know, that the physical becomes transformed. There are processes of ascension devoted to transforming the physical, where one acquires more of what's called the light body and becomes less and less dense, and we get closer to what we would call probably an angelic form.
Now, I've heard of some accounts of ETs and UFOs that are referred to actually as light ships, or these beings have light bodies. And what are your thoughts on those actually being similar to some of these spiritual beings that appear in bodies of light? Do you think they might be related, or they might be the same thing, or...
They could be related, or they could just be coming from another dimension, you know, perhaps a parallel dimension close to ours, where their form is much different, and it's how it would manifest in our environment. like I was saying, it gets very hard to draw definite boundaries around a lot of these things. The paranormal itself is a shapeshifter.
Yeah.
It's very fluid. And
that's part of the problem.
It really is, because we want definite, concrete, black and white white answers. So some of those experiences may be involving what you would call etherealized entities, and others may be, you know, that's just the form that, you know, John Keel coined the term ultra-terrestrial, which I think is so great.
Yeah.
It explains so many things coming from parallel dimensions. Several years ago, I wanted to mention, here again, this is how do we interpret things. I did a very informal dream study with a colleague of mine from the International Association for the Study of Dreams, Carol Warner, who's a professional psychologist. And we were interested in looking at ET dreams. How do people experience ETs in dreams, and how do they interpret them? So we solicited dreams in which there were ETs in the dreams, that they were more like symbolic of things, encounter dreams, lucid dreams, you know, and that sort of thing. And I was quite surprised, and we got quite a few responses in, and what really surprised me was, because I already had a body of dream encounters with angels from having done years of research and several books on angels, and I was quite surprised to find that so many of the dreams were so similar, they were almost identical in ways. In fact, you could strip out the label angel and the label ET, and you would have the same experience, exactly the same. So the question in my mind is, well, what makes one person interpret this experience as angelic and another person interpret this experience as ET? Because they didn't always involve, like, ships and things like that. And so, you know, we went back to the dreamers to get more information. And, you know, this is how subjective things are, that people put things into a context that is meaningful to them. So ultimately the answer is, it's not that one is right and one is wrong. People are having these genuine experiences of the same, but they're putting different labels on it. But that's how they get their meaning. That's how they find their personal truth. There is still something behind those guises. And when I say guises, I don't mean it as a deceitful sort of thing. There has to be some way for us to experience these things that the human brain and consciousness can comprehend. Otherwise, you know, we don't have the experience. It has to be something that we can make meaning out of. And that's where the power of the experience is. I've always told people that they have to find their own truth to get the power of the experience, the transformative power of the experience, but to also keep looking, because there is still something behind that. And I think that's what all of us are searching for. All the people in ufology, all the paranormal researchers, the angelologists, the demonologists, the near-death experience studiers, the spirit communication studiers, we're all looking for that truth.
Yeah, it's interesting that you brought that up, that, you know, I know that our brains have this pattern recognition function. It's how we recognize things, and it's how we learn about them and identify things that might be a threat, you know, something that was a problem in the past. We want to see it quickly, as quickly as possible. And, yeah, that's how our brains work. When we see something new, we automatically run through the databanks and try to find something similar to it so we can figure out what this new thing is. But that can be a problem, and I'm sure you've come across this in paranormal research, as in anything else, where, you know, you see photos and somebody will give you a picture and say, oh, my God, there's a face in this picture, and you see that it's like leaves in a tree. And, yeah, it does sort of make a face, but that doesn't mean it's a spirit there. And people say, well, I got this picture of a demon, you know, and it's in the clouds or it's in the trees. Or it just seems like that's something we all really have to watch out for. Because maybe there is a spirit appearing in the trees, but I think it would be awfully easy to fool ourselves on something like that, too. Is that something that you see often in your investigations?
I certainly do in the paranormal. I do spend a fair amount of time doing, you know, field investigations, you know, hauntings, and I do spirit communications work, you know, real-time spirit communications experiments and things like that. So I'm often dealing with people who are taking photographs in haunted places hoping to get some evidence. And, yes, there is a tendency to want to see something extraordinary in the ordinary. And so the background gets interpreted as faces or forms. I've seen so many orb pictures, I can't stand it anymore. there are orb pictures that are very interesting and I think are unexplained, but, you know, most of them are explained.
Yeah, what do you think about orbs? That seems to be another hot topic these days.
It certainly is. And, you know, people get very upset if you tell them that their orbs are dust particles. And I think that has to do with the fact that we want to engage the unseen. Mm-hmm. We want to experience the paranormal. There are a lot of people out there who really want to have some extraordinary experiences. I think, you know, I'm like most paranormal investigators. The overwhelming majority of orb photographs are easily explained by dust, moisture in the air, things in front of the camera lens. We never saw very many orb pictures before digital photography. A few, yes, here and there, but they've been rampant since digital photography became widely available. On the other hand, I have seen some orb photographs that I can't explain. So I'm open-minded about at least some of them, that perhaps we have developed the technology to capture something that has heretofore been largely unseen. And I read with great interest a book that came out a couple of years ago called The Orb Project.
I just got that book. I haven't read it yet.
Well, it's very interesting, and you know, you've got two co-authors there with a lot of very good credentials in technical and scientific backgrounds, and you know, they're making a case for orbs as an unexplored, unidentified spirit form or energy, and I think we have to be open to that possibility.
Now, you mentioned that we didn't see orbs with the older cameras. There's a question about that on the message board, and I just want to clarify it. That I think you mentioned there are a lot more orbs being photographed now with the advent of digital photography, but did they not appear at all on the old film cameras?
Oh, they could, yes, but it not very commonly,
not
like now.
And there are, I mean, I'm not that familiar with photo analysis. That's something I need to look into, but there are ways that analysts can identify orbs that are reflections of water droplets in the air or dust particles. Isn't that true?
I can't answer that for certain. I would think so.
Yeah, that's something I really need to learn a lot more about photo analysis. There's so much to it. And just when I start to get the handle on something, they come out with some kind of new camera technology, and I have to start all over again. You know?
Well, for example, a lot of the photographs that I see, they're in buildings with a lot of dust on the floor or dirt floors, and of course you're going to have, you know, stuff floating around in the air, or they're taken outdoors where you've got a lot of, you know, things flying around in the air too, and moisture can show up with, you don't see it with your eye, but it can show up in a photograph. And these are all hazards. So we have to be very careful about just seeing every fuzzy dot on a photograph as a spirit presence.
Right. It is tempting. But, yeah, we do have to be careful about that sort of thing.
The orbs that I find the most interesting are actually the ones captured on video that are moving. And that would have some unusual properties to them, like you know, people have seen moving orbs that seem to have intelligence behind them. You know, Stan Romanek has talked about that, and you know, his experiences and his case where orbs have come in and moved around the house and you know, seem to act with intelligence. And I've heard that in other cases too. And those are the ones that I find actually more interesting than the ones captured on still photographs.
Yeah, that's something I don't quite know how to handle, that whole concept of the orbs moving and seeming to be intelligently controlled. And that kind of makes me think of the UFOs, that, you know, you get these spherical UFOs that might be incredibly huge, or you might get these really, really tiny ones. I mean, they can be any range of sizes, just like the orbs. You know, they can appear very small in photos, or they can appear much larger. I talked with Claude Swanson once. I remember him telling us a story, and he was talking with someone who had been trying to photograph ghosts, and the man was very frustrated. He said, I can't get any ghost photos. All I get are these, you know, these balls and these streaks on all my pictures. I was laughing. He's like, you got them. That's what they look like.
He probably wanted them to look a little more human-like.
I think that was it. I think he was looking for, like, the gray lady or something, you know.
Well, I will say this, speaking about photographs of apparitions, because, you know, I see a lot of photographs over the course of a year. And who knows how something from another dimension or another plane of existence or the dead, you know, who knows exactly how they should show up in a photograph. But my feeling is that a genuine photograph, the figure is going to be obviously not entirely in this dimension. In other words, it's not going to be very well formed. It's
right.
Not going to have distinct edges to it. The best unexplained photographs, for example, of apparitions are like this. They have very little definition to them. I have seen some unexplained that are sharper and clearer, but by and large, there's something missing from them. They're not complete. They don't have feet or legs or hands, or something blurs out on them. If I see photographs where the forms are too sharp, too distinct, too well formed, and I get this a lot with shadow people, people sending me photographs that they think are shadow people.
Wow.
If they're too well formed, I'm highly skeptical of them. In fact, sometimes I think if they've been taken on investigations, they've just accidentally captured somebody walking around in the dark.
Oh, that's an interesting point. Actually, that raises a point that I wanted to discuss with you, but I'm going to have to bring it up after the break because we've gone through the entire first hour already. I can't believe we've done this. I've had such a great time talking with you. So we are going to go and take a quick break, and I think I'm having some technical problems with my phone here, too, that I'm also going to try to take care of.
Hi, you've got to listen to ICAR, that's International Community for Alien Research, www.icar1.com. I should know, I'm Irish.
Light up your night with The Kevin Smith Show. Hi, this is Kevin Smith. Join me Monday through Friday right here on the Paranormal Radio Network.
Fall is in the air. October is a magical month, highlighted at the very end by Halloween. Some would think that Halloween is the most paranormal of holidays, and while we can debate whether or not it is, we all love some laughter and fun. Bobbing for apples and trick-or-treating, pumpkins, jack-o'-lanterns, the smell of baking apples, shot corn, wreaths of wheat, hay rides, cow tipping, strange, scary monsters, goblins, ghosts, and witches of every sort, all are a part of our collective memories of this month. Stay tuned to the Paranormal Radio Network and don't miss Magic of This Month.
Well, I saw the thing coming out of the sky. It had a one long horn and one big eye. I commenced shaking and I said, ooh-wee. It looks like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
A one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One-eyed.
Oh, well, he came down to earth and he lit in a tree. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff,
I wouldn't eat you, 'cause you're so tough.
It was the one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One horn.
I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, what's your line? He said, eating purple people, and it sure is fine. But that's not the reason that I came to land.
Rock and roll band.
Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater, pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater.
We wear short shorts.
Friendly little people eater, what a sight to see.
Oh!
And then he swung from the tree and he lit on the ground and he started to rock, but really rocking around. It was a crazy ditty with a swinging tune. Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater, pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater.
I like
short
shorts,
flying purple people eater.
What a sight to see.
Purple people.
Well, he went on his way, and then what do you know? I saw him last night on a TV show. He was blowing it out, really knocking him dead, playing rock and roll music through the horn in his head.
Are you a fan of the unknown?
Do you constantly watch the sky, wondering if there's something out there?
In fear of things going bump in the night.
Bigfoot Radio brings you headfirst into the world of the paranormal with the latest news and interviews with the paranormal elite.
With hosts Jordan Klein and Nick Queen, you are sure to be consumed in the world of ghosts, UFOs, cryptozoology, conspiracy theories, and the unknown.
So check out Whispers Radio every Tuesday night, 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 to 7 Central. And give us a call, 1-866-514-1600.
Visit us at www.whispersradio.com.
Hey, hi there. Got your attention? I'm Gia Scott, and I was curious what you were doing from 7 to 9 p.m. Central Time on Tuesdays. See, I host this really interesting little radio program that airs live then, and we bring in all sorts of guests. Authors, experiencers, and everything in between. It's paranormal and guaranteed to make you go, My guest list is always up at www.giascott.com, and do tune in to the Dawn of Shades from 7 to 9 p.m. on Tuesdays.
Get your dose of truth with the Truth Hurts Radio Show with your host Charles Giuliani, Mondays, 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern. The truth hurts, ignorance kills.
Are you interested in a radio program that focuses on the deeper aspects of the UFO topic? Would you like to explore the facts and truths of what ufology and UFO research are all about? Then, join us here every Saturday evening at 7 p.m. Eastern on the UFO Paranormal Radio Network for Eye to the Sky, UFO Synopsis, with your host, D. Andrew.
Do you like to ask questions about everything? Would you like to escape from your proverbial box? Just leap out and explore our world in ways you've never imagined? You can have that opportunity. As we grow and expand, new features will be added, allowing you to experience radio programming at a fresh new level. I invite you to join me, November Hansen, host of Voice of the People. Together, we can expand our horizons and peer into multifaceted possibilities. This program will broadcast live Saturday evenings on the Paranormal Radio Network.
UPRN 105 is about to get a little darker. Dark Plains Radio Show is coming to UPRN 105. Don't miss your flight into the unknown.
We'd like to invite you to listen to the Joyner Report, hosted by journalist and researcher Angela Joyner, as she looks into the UFO topic from a fresh perspective. The Joyner Report can be heard every Friday evening at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, right here on the UFO Paranormal Radio Network.
Hi, this is James Atha Yanchik, the Black Knight of Talk Radio, inviting you to join me on a road to truth via the path of non-contradiction. Join us each week on Feet to the Fire, a show with the goals of examining a subject matter on its own merits and test how it stands up to the many possibilities found in reality, all without pre-drawn conclusions found in personal bias. No left or right wings here. No pounding the pulpit of ego-driven my way or the highway attitudes. But there are no free passes given either. Answers to questions are important, but equally important is the reasons and methods used to find the answer. The lack of contradiction is the final judge here. On Feet to the Fire.
Feet.
Sunday evenings.
To fire.
How do you listen?
Fire.
www.feettofire.com for more information.
Hi everyone, Trish Sheridan speaking. Come join us for the program, A Global Focus, every Monday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central, where we'll discuss the full spectrum of ufology and related topics. Hope you'll be listening.
When it comes to the oil crisis, we are all passengers on the Titanic. With global oil production peaking and demand steadily increasing over the long term, oil prices will soon be back to the levels of last year and even higher. If we stay on the current path, we will hit the iceberg. Hydrogen fuel cell vehicles are the solution to the oil crisis. They are the only technology that can be scaled up globally and meet customer requirements for driving range, fueling time, cost when mass produced, extreme weather performance, and trunk and passenger space. While the hydrogen to power these vehicles will initially come from natural gas, this is better than gasoline and only a bridge to hydrogen from wind and solar. Major car companies have hundreds of hydrogen fuel cell vehicles on the road today, and they will be arriving at dealerships by 2015. But the hydrogen fueling infrastructure needs to be built. Contact your members of Congress today and tell them to start building the hydrogen fueling infrastructure now. Give our planet a break and America back its future. Brought to you by AmericansForAHydrogenEconomy.org.
Hey everybody, Jesse Hobbs here to tell you about a new show that will be airing on the Paranormal Radio Network called UFO News 24/7. This is a program hosted by myself that will give weekly updates on current UFO sightings across the nation and around the globe. We will give you sightings ripped directly from the headlines across the world and submissions from viewers like you who submit stories for us to air. If you have a UFO story you think that we'd be interested in hearing, please email us at UFO_news247@yahoo.com. And we look forward to hearing from everyone, and tune in September 5th for our premiere show. Thank you.
Hi, this is Rob Simone, and I want to tell you about my brand new show here on the Paranormal Radio Network. Each week, I bring you the most interesting people on the planet, the most in-depth discussions, and the most controversial issues. We go where no talk show dares to go. Join me every week for the Rob Simone Talk Show here on the UFO Paranormal Radio Network.
To UFO Undercover, Wednesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern, with your host, Joe Montaldo, right here on the Paranormal Radio Network.
This is Alejandro Rojas, the host of Open Minds Radio, a show focused on UFO news and updates. Join me every Thursday right here on the UFO Paranormal Network at 5 p.m. Central for the latest in UFO news and some wonderful guests who are going to share their insights or their experiences with this, the enigmatic UFO phenomenon.
You're listening to the UFO Paranormal Radio Network. That's www.ufoparanormalradio.com.
On the Paranormal Radio Network and on UPRN 105.5 FM in New Orleans. Thanks for bearing with us during the break. If you were here for the first hour, you'll notice I did kind of an abrupt cut to break right at the end there. My cordless phone actually ran out of charge, so I apologize for not doing my usual, you know, easy kind of going out to break and station ID and all of that. Don't want you guys to think that I suddenly turned unprofessional. Anyway, I'm your host, Karen Dolan, and my guest this evening is Rosemary Ellen Guiley, and we have been talking about her work in paranormal investigation and her many books on the subject. I was blown away to find that she'd written over 40 books and is hard at work on another one, which she mentioned during the first hour. Rosemary, thanks again for joining me this evening. I know that at the end of the first hour we were talking about photos and orbs and things that appear in photo evidence. And you're talking about shadow people and how sometimes people will show you pictures of what they claim to be ghosts or entities or shadow people, and that it seems a little odd to you when they seem too sharply defined, because these beings usually don't appear that way. And the point that I just wanted to bring up to get back into this was that it seems like that's almost a catch-22 that we see in UFO research and also in paranormal research, that if you don't get a good photo, people say, well, I don't know, that's not a very good picture, I can't really see anything. And if you do, then people, skeptics especially, will say, I don't know, that's too good, it looks fake. So what constitutes a good picture, good photographic evidence of something like this.
You know, Karen, you've raised a very good point about the catch-22, and that's true, and we see it in the paranormal as well. The problem is that we simply don't know what other dimensional entities or the dead should look like in a photograph. And we don't have any, you know, we can't summon up entities on demand to do photographic sittings for us. So we have only our spontaneous, random photographs to look at for evidence. I've looked at so many photographs over the years. I have my own kind of intuitive feel for them, of what I think is probably unexplained versus probably having an explanation. And I hate to be so conditional on that, but we don't have any definitive rules. Even the best unexplained photographs are still not considered proof of anything or even genuine. They're just simply unexplained. Mm-hmm. So the things that I have noticed over the course of time and also looking at different photographs of purportedly different entities is that the ones that seem the best candidates for unexplained have a lack of definition to them. And I do believe that that could be caused by an interdimensional bleed-through, that something that is not of this world, that manifests temporarily in this world, is not going to be visually as defined as something that's already in this world. And so these figures have, they're not completely formed, or they may even seem malformed, which I've seen in the case of some shadow people photographs. They're lacking definition. For example, no facial features or very blurry ones. Quite often when people have visual experiences, the figures are that way. They trail off at the bottom. They don't touch the ground. There may be no definitions to hands or feet, or something is incomplete about them, and I think that's because they're not completely formed in this dimension. Now, that doesn't explain 100% of people's experiences or photographs either. Certainly people do have experiences where entities seem to be very, very clear and sharp to them. I have seen photographs of ghosts and shadow figures and things like supposedly fairies and that have some clarity to them, you know, what I feel is probably a little too much clarity. But again, I'm going on my gut feeling that I've just developed over years and years of looking at these photographs, and we're all pretty much in the same boat. We don't have any universal definitive rules to go by.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned fairies. What are your thoughts on the Cottingley fairies? I remember one of the big arguments against them was that they looked too sharp and clear.
Well, the two girls involved, you know, they did confess years later to a hoax.
Yeah, but didn't one of them then later, years after that, say, "I just said it, that we faked it so people would leave me alone"? So, it seems to me that the case is still sort of open. A hoax sounds plausible, but the idea of just saying that so people would stop pestering them sounds pretty plausible, too.
Very true, and the circumstances of the case seem to be that when they were out in the woods, the girls had these encounters with these fairies, and when they told the adults laughed it off. My feeling was that they probably did have some genuine experiences. The photographs, all of the photographs seemed to me hoaxed. The figures look cut out. They look sort of pasted onto things.
Yeah, they're incredibly sharp and clear, and they don't look real to me because they're too clear. They're too perfect.
they're too clear, and also they're these tiny little wing things. And those actually don't conform with the bulk of anecdotal experience recorded in the fairy lore over the years. The tiny little wing things were popularized in Victorian art. So their images, well, we can't rule them out. They don't conform to the bulk of descriptions, you know, given in the anecdotal lore. I think, however, they probably did have some genuine experiences.
So I guess that's something that probably happens a lot, too, now that you mention it, that people have actual experiences, that they see things that maybe don't appear to all their friends and family, and so they might try to recreate what they saw. And, you know, it comes off sounding like a hoax, but in their minds they might just be thinking, look, I know this is real, I don't know why you can't see it, so now you can see it too. And, you know, maybe that's partly what these girls were thinking.
You know, who knows what went through the head of an 11-year-old and a 17-year-old at the time.
I don't know. I have an 11-year-old, and I don't know what goes through her head.
Well, you know, I ran into similar things in looking when I did a lot of research on physical mediumship from, the late 1800s into, you know, about the mid-1900s. And these photographs of ectoplasm perplexed me. And, you know, there are all these cases of alleged fraud on the part of mediums about how they swallowed things and secreted stuff on their bodies to produce phony ectoplasm. But then there were these other cases where this substance seemed to exude from the bodies of mediums and was unexplained. The texture, the smell, the consistency of it, the volume of it, and that it would supposedly be this, like a plastic sort of medium for a spirit to manifest something, like faces or body parts, something like that. And you look at these photographs, and, you know, it looks like, you know, half-congealed Elmer's glue coming out of them.
Yeah, I've seen some of those photos there.
And you think, well, surely this must be faked. But then, you know, when I voiced these doubts to a parapsychologist, he said, well, what should ectoplasm look like? How do we know?
Mm-hmm.
So we're often left with these, you know, kind of big enchilada questions hanging out there that, you know, what yardstick do we use to measure these things against? Now, I have never seen ectoplasm exude from the body of a medium, so I don't have firsthand visual experience myself. I've only examined all of these photographs. So I you know, ultimately, I don't know.
It goes back to what we were talking about in the first hour, how we have this way of wanting to classify things, and we want to identify things. And, you know, I at least find myself having to watch this tendency to try to label things and stick them in their little pigeonhole, because there's just so much. You start looking around in this field and you find so much that's just unidentifiable, and it's all this big stew, and you don't quite know which things belong together and which ones don't, and it's so tempting to try to sort it out and classify it, and we can't. You know, we just don't have enough information about most of these things.
Which is why the paranormal is so uncomfortable for so many people, because it defies categorization, it defies definition. Mm-hmm. It's not black and white. You can't just compartmentalize it. It doesn't fit neatly into things. It's like quicksilver, it slides around, it shape shifts, it morphs, it appears, it vanishes. You're often left with more questions than answers after experiences. It's no wonder that people want to disbelieve or even dismiss it, because it just doesn't operate according to rules we think it should operate by.
Yeah, it's one of those things that either really sucks people in, you get caught by it, and you just can't drop it. You could spend the rest of your life studying the paranormal, because there are always more questions, and it's fascinating. Or it could just be too much and completely repel someone. Say, I just can't go there. I can understand people saying that. I don't feel that way. I'm one of those people who got sucked in, and I just, I can't drop it.
Yeah, me too. The deeper I go, the more questions I have, and the fewer definitive answers I can give to a lot of things. Years and years ago, I probably had far more definitive ideas about the paranormal than I do now, because I've been exposed to so much that defies explanation or can be explained from a number of different perspectives, and which one is it? Because some of them might be radically different. This is what propels me and keeps me going. Mm-hmm. And I think all of us who get deeply into the research on this, you do get, the deeper you go, the more intrigued you get.
Yeah. Yeah, we were talking about spirits and spirits of the dead, and there was a question on the message board a few minutes ago that I wanted to pass on. One of our listeners wanted to know whether you personally are able to contact spirits.
I have had communication with entities. I should say I've purported communication, because here again, we have really no way of proving what we're actually dealing with. I've had mediumistic communication. I don't really consider myself a medium, but over the course of time, I've taken a lot of training to develop the psychic ability that I have, and that did include some mediumistic communication. And then I have been working for some years in experimenting with devices that, mostly radio sweep devices, that are intended for real-time two-way communication. And some of them are known popularly as Frank's boxes. Radio sweep is the better generic term for them, because they employ scanning devices that scan like the radio AM band very rapidly. It creates a choppy noise matrix that spirit seems to, the idea is that spirit modulates it or manipulates it in order to form communication that is delivered independent of the scan. It's not part of the radio scan itself. Now, in experimenting with these devices, I have gotten many communications that seem to be evidential. That is, I can't explain them naturally. They're answers, direct answers to questions. They come from people who identify themselves as either entities or dead people. There's never any lengthy dialogue. The technology does not seem to facilitate like lengthy conversations so that you can collect a lot of data and try and verify it. In other words, I can't prove that I communicated with anything that I think I did. And that's often the case with spirit communications. How do we prove that we really are talking to the dead or to aliens or other kinds of entities?
Yeah, I guess usually we have to fall back on something like prophecy or, you know, having for them to reveal some sort of information that the communicator wouldn't have had any way of knowing.
Well, even that's problematic.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's this inconvenient little, you know, theory out there called super psi. And now, I have to admit, I'm a believer. I've had enough of my own experiences that I believe that these experiences are genuine. There are things out there. The super psi idea is an argument applied by disbelievers to explain away the phenomena. And the uncomfortable thing is that you can't, even with the super psi theory, you can't disprove it, you can't prove it. But the basic tenet of it is that even information given by communicators that supposedly the medium doesn't know, or the sitters don't know, other people don't know, that, you know, is their bona fides, you know, proves who they say they are, that information exists somewhere. And we do not know the bounds of consciousness or our psychic faculties to access and acquire information.
Mm-hmm.
So conceivably, the human mind could reach into some, you know, cosmic computer file and access that information which may not come from an entity at all. It may come from traveling human consciousness.
Now, some of us might say that's just as interesting.
That's true.
That the mind can do that, you know, it can access information in ways other than through the physical senses.
So are we, for example, talking to an entity, or are we talking to a construct projected from human consciousness?
Right.
Well, over the course of time, I have come to believe that the living participate in the paranormal phenomena experience far more than we think we do.
Mm-hmm.
There's an element of living consciousness wrapped up in this that can't be separated out. And how much of that creates or manipulates the experience, I think those are the big unknowns. I've often thought that our experiences in haunted places, for example, are a way for the living to stay connected to the past, that the living project onto a haunting phenomena, which is not to say that the phenomena themselves don't exist, but we are not discrete observers. We're not separate from this process. We're an integral part of the process of our experiences. And so how much of it comes from us and how much of it might be external, who knows?
Mm-hmm.
And these are very uncomfortable questions for a lot of people to think about, because I would say most of the people who get attracted to the paranormal or even become engaged in any amount of research are looking for the externals.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of this may be coming from us.
Yeah. Now, when you say that you have made contact with spirits, you know, there's another question here. And this actually was, the question was brought up by Angela Joyner, who I understand you know.
Oh, I do, yes. Yeah, we communicate on Facebook all the time.
Yeah, well, she's in the chat room.
Hi, Angela.
And there are quite a few people asking questions on the message board and saying hello to you, but I don't think you're in the chat room tonight, are you? So I'm trying to pass these on.
I'm not near my computer.
Okay. Well, she was asking specifically, have you contacted spirits of people who you knew when they were alive? And I don't know if this kind of goes back to the whole explanation that we were just talking about, that, you know, it may or may not, you know, the consciousness that you're contacting may or may not be of that other person.
Mm-hmm. In terms of, like, mediumistically communicating with someone, I've had spontaneous experiences, but not anything that I initiated. I don't really work as a medium, for one thing. And so my mediumistic experiences tend to be spontaneous, like when I'm out somewhere, usually in the course of an investigation, and something intrudes wishing to communicate. And so I haven't, like, dialed up mom or dad, who are both on the other side. I have had experiences with both of them. Both of them in lucid dream encounters. But no, if, for example, in the spirit communications work that I've been doing with the radio sweep devices, what I've usually gotten from people are first names only. And it seems like these bridges are very brief and fleeting. And you ask follow-up questions, and either they're gone or the link is gone. Now, there are some researchers around the world who say they've been able to link up to more sustained conversations, where they've been able to literally call up specific dead people. There's some very interesting research going on in Brazil, for example. A few years ago, I met Sonia Rinaldi, who's one of the big researchers down there doing this intentional two-way communication, in which she helps grieving people, and she has a telephone computer set up that she developed, and she says she is able to contact specific individuals on the other side and get messages for their family.
Through a telephone and a computer? I'm sorry. Through a telephone and a computer?
It's. I'm not really clear on the exact setup, but it's some sort of loop like that.
Thomas Edison would be so pleased.
Well, we don't really know whether it is. Yeah, we don't really know whether he actually did a device or not. He made some comments.
The story is that he was trying to. That's why he did all those experiments, wasn't it?
Well, it's highly debatable. You know, I mean, there's a lot of controversy about it. There's absolutely no proof that he ever developed a machine. I've been doing some research along this for a book I'm doing on high-tech spirit communications that I'm co-authoring with George Norrie. It's another one of my big projects. It's been quite exciting for the last couple of years. And that book will be out next year. But, you know, we've been looking at the Edison question, did he or didn't he? And he's certainly made a number of statements in the media about there ought to be such a device, and there needed to be better ways for the living to communicate with the dead than table tilting and Ouija boards and things like that. But nobody can ever find any paperwork to document that. There's apparently nothing on file at the patent office that anyone's been able to turn up. That is, I've read accounts. You know, secondhand accounts that supposedly people close to Edison saw such a machine. I've seen descriptions of it, that it had an aluminum trumpet and involved something, you know, with a phonograph. And no such surviving device is known. And
I don't think I had ever heard that he had achieved it, but I thought that was what drove him. That's what he was always trying to reach, was some kind of machine that would allow him to communicate with the dead. And I just thought it was so cool that somebody finally did it.
Well,
he'd be so excited if he knew someone got there.
Well, even that's debatable.
Yeah.
Because now later in his life, he seemed to have gotten a lot more philosophical, and he did expound on, you know, some metaphysical things in interviews. But on the other hand, he was often disdainful of people who were trying to do spirit communications.
Hmm.
So, you know, where his true feelings were, it's kind of hard to say. But he did at least speculate on the concept of a telephone to the dead, and even during his lifetime, there were researchers who were very interested in marrying telephone technology to recording technology to attempts to communicate with the other side. We've had mysterious messages from the beginning. I mean, even Morse code, there's a whole history of mystery messages obtained through Morse code and through the phonograph, the radio. Experiments were done in the 1920s to try and record spirit voices, and that has escalated over the decades with experiments involving passive EVP, like putting a recorder out and listening to it later, to what's called either real-time EVP or real-time two-way communication. Now, I've had entities identify themselves, too. And Phil and I had some interesting experiments when we were starting the research on the Jinn book. And here again, is this projections from us or from some cosmic trickster or what? You know, entities, we say, who are you? And the answer comes back, Jinn, or demons. I had one case where I said, oh, demons, who is with you besides demons? And the answer came back, Satan. So, what are you really dealing with?
Yeah. Well, that's just it. You don't know if someone's just yanking your chain from the other side. Because I have to say, I would be like that. You know, if I were a spirit and somebody contacted me through a Ouija board, I would be so tempted to say all these really scary things just to make them jump.
Well, and that does happen. I think everyone who's worked in EVP and real time has had experiences with tricky communicators and even nasty communicators. They're up on YouTube. I do have a short video up on YouTube involving a couple of interesting communications I got about a year and a half ago at a haunted investigation at the Lincoln Theater in Decatur, Illinois. And these were recorded by Joey Tito from the Ghost Research Society of Chicago. I do a lot of work with them. And there are two clips, and in one of the clips, I always try and ask questions several times to make sure that I haven't misunderstood something or to try and get the same answer. And in one clip, I asked if there were any communicators who wished to say anything. Did they know anyone present? And male and female voices answer and say, Joey. Well, the guy who's videotaping me, his name is Joey Tito. And I said, Joey, do you know Joey? There's a Joey in the theater. And the voices say, yes, that's him, that's him. And that's all we got out of them. Who were they? And but whoever they were, they said they knew Joey. And then the second clip, which I thought was kind of interesting. Now, I have heard, you know, my name a number of times in this real-time spirit communication work. And again, I asked if there were any communicators who wished to identify themselves, and a female voice said, Rachel. And so I said, Rachel, who is Rachel? You know, why are you here in the theater? And she said, author, Rosemary.
Oh, wow.
I do not know a Rachel on the other side. I didn't get anything more from that particular communicator. Like I was saying, it seems like these links are very tenuous, and I think that there's probably more communication going on. We're just not hearing the whole thing. And it may be the same on the other side. They may not be able to hear us very clearly either.
That makes a lot of sense. Were you, I'm sorry, I may have missed this, were you using a Ouija board at all?
No, I was using one of these radio sweep devices.
Oh, okay.
So the voices actually come across these devices. You hear them real time.
Oh, wow.
And it's, some people find that, I would say a little unsettling.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's one thing to listen to something you recorded and you're playing it back, but to hear something real time
and realize it's in the room with you right now.
Exactly, and that, you know, this is live, folks. It's like live TV. Again, we have no way of proving what we're communicating with. It is very exciting work, I think, and I tell people controversial, it's unreliable because you don't know exactly what you're getting. You don't get the same thing twice. But how on earth are we going to make progress unless we keep doing the work? Someone asked me, well, if it's so controversial and unreliable, why are you doing it? And it's like, well, we have to keep experimenting so we can develop the technology to get to those points where we stand a chance of getting something very reliable that we can start validating things with. And so I encourage people to do the work. There's very few in the scientific community who take this sort of thing seriously. It's in the hands. There are people who have science and technical backgrounds who are doing the work around the world. Paranormal, you know, lay paranormal investigators are doing a lot of it too, but we need to simply collect data so that we can look for patterns and tinker with things, develop better equipment. I really do believe that we have the capability of producing the technology to make those links that we can get communication that we someday can prove.
I had a question, actually, I wanted to ask you. I think we have about 9 or 10 minutes left on the show. the subject of Ouija boards came up, and you also mentioned George Norrie's name recently, and you probably know what I'm going to ask you, but were you not involved with this the Ouija board project or the Ouija board experiment that George Norrie had planned to do on Coast to Coast once?
Yes, that was, I think it was a couple of summers ago. Yes, we were going to work a Ouija board live on the air, and George was, his idea behind it was to demonstrate that, you know, a lot of people think the Ouija board is a demonic instrument and bad things are going to happen if you use it, and so, you know, his idea was, so, well, let's do an experiment and see what happens. So I went out to L.A. I took two antique Ouija boards out with me, and the other parties were Bruce Goldberg, who's a past life expert, and Jordan Maxwell, who had the role of the skeptic, the disbeliever, the, you know, let's not do this, you know, very conservative point of view. And we were going to talk about it and then work it live on the air. Well, George decided that night that we would not do it on the air. And he had a lot of reasons for doing so, and they were very sound, and I think he made the right decision. I've never considered the Ouija board a demonic instrument, and I think that, yes, people can have bad experiences with it. They have bad experiences with anything that they tinker around with in the paranormal. But a lot of people in the listening audience were very uneasy about this, and I think people have believed, you know, what they've seen from Hollywood, like The Exorcist and Witch Board and things like that, and were urging him not to do it because they were afraid bad things were going to happen. That, I mean, we were getting calls that we were going to open up portals to hordes of demons and, you know, things like that. So in the interest of not upsetting his, you know, the people out there, he decided it would be a good idea not to do it live on air. And actually, the worst thing that would have happened would have been dead air. You know, nothing could have happened.
Yeah, that was my
very anticlimactic.
Yeah, that was the thing that I was most concerned about happening, was that there was just going to be very quiet and nothing would happen.
And that would be so typical of Trickster.
Exactly. That's likely to happen, even if there's somebody there. Like, well, I'm not talking while the microphone is on, you know. And, of course, if I were in a studio and something like that were happening, I would feel obligated to say something so there would be some kind of sound, and that would probably make it even less likely that anything would happen.
Well, another one of my book projects I'm doing is a book on the Ouija board. And I just a couple of weeks ago interviewed Bob Birch, who is probably the world's leading expert on the Ouija board. He's researched the history up one side and down the other. He has 500 boards. And I'm looking at things like the history of it. It does have a very wacky, strange history, how it's been portrayed in film and fiction, how it's been distorted in the media and by conservative people, religious people who basically use it as a, you know, as a weapon against people in terms of exhorting them not to experiment in the paranormal. And this is a book that I'm co-authoring with another expert, Rick Fisher, who's a well-known paranormalist in Pennsylvania, a very good friend of mine I've investigated with for years. We've culled out over 100 years of history from the media on the Ouija board, and there are some very strange cases out there of people doing bizarre things and committing murder and getting divorced and engaging in all kinds of weird things because spirits, they say that spirits told them to do, spirits they consulted on the Ouija board told them to do it. But the board itself is a benign device. It's neither good nor evil. It's an interface to the spirit realm. And you can have good experiences or bad experiences. I think things have been distorted with the Ouija board that people tend to report more bad experiences because it's kind of gotten a black reputation, and movies like The Exorcist have not helped.
Well, I remember reading books by Ed and Lorraine Warren, and they always came down very hard on Ouija boards.
Unfortunately, yeah, I know. To them, the Ouija board was a automatic welcome mat to Satan, and that's just simply not the case. I don't think that any tool to open the door to spirit is automatically going to invite either good or evil forces through it. You have the potential to encounter both whenever you go looking to engage the paranormal. People bring biases to things, and I think we've acquired literally an archetypal bias against the Ouija board because of some of these sensational things about it, and that this operates in the subconscious of a lot of the people who use it, and consequently, weird things do happen. Not to everybody. I've experimented with just about every form of spirit communication tool that I can find, and nothing has ever convinced me that it's an automatic good or bad experience. I've never even had a bad one through the Ouija board. I don't use any device as a regular practice, but I've worked with them because I want to understand how they operate and what the experiences with them are like. And, you know, I had one when I was a kid. So we can't say that they're automatically going to unleash demons or that you're going to be possessed. It just simply does, you know, the facts of the matter do not bear that out.
Is there anything that you would recommend that people who want to use a Ouija board could or should do to protect themselves and to keep from opening a door, as people say? I mean, I'm thinking maybe it's not the tool itself that's blamed, but the fact that a lot of people are using it wrong because they don't realize that there's anything they should be doing to make it safer.
Yeah, I think a lot of people approach something like the Ouija board as a thrill-seeking device, and teenagers can have problems with the paranormal. I think, you know, they tend to be fairly open sometimes. I've always felt that the best possible protection that you can do for yourself is to have a regular spiritual practice of prayer and meditation and a spiritual grounding. That engenders an automatic protection from within, no matter what you do. People can go through rituals, they can say prayers, they can carry stones in their pockets, whatever, and those are not going to guarantee anything. Those are symbolic items that can help us connect to a protective spiritual power, but that connection must come from within. And the best way to foster that is to spend time every day in prayer or meditation connecting to the divine.
Okay, I was wondering about things like visualizing white light surrounding themselves in the room and, you know, protecting the people who are there.
It certainly can help, and I think that especially for people beginning engagement in the paranormal or who have made some uncertainties out there, visualizations such as putting white light around you, a prayer for protection, and that you wish only to come into contact with something benevolent and beneficial are very helpful and can certainly go a long way. I've always stressed the need for the inner source because a lot of times you may not have all the outer trappings involved.
Mm-hmm.
Years and years ago, I used to go through a conscious ritual for opening up and closing down. And I don't anymore, not because I've gotten blasé about it or I take it for granted. It's just become an intrinsic part of me. And so I automatically feel protected whenever I I engage in this work. Sometimes if I know I'm going into a problematic situation or a heavy negative environment, I'll invoke something extra. But for years I have spent time in pursuing a spiritual path, mm-hmm. which is not necessarily a religious path.
Yeah.
There is a difference between the two. I've studied meditation, and I've pursued mystical practices as well. But daily prayer meditation alters your energy space. It refines your aura. It puts you in connection with something greater than yourself. And it brings an energy into the mind, the spirit, and the body. And that's some of the best armor you can have.
Okay. On the note, we're going to have to end it because we have blown through the second hour now. It feels like about 5 minutes went by since we came back.
It certainly does, Karen.
I really, really enjoyed talking with you tonight, Rosemary. Thank you so much for joining me. My guest has been Rosemary Ellen Guiley, paranormal investigator and author of, I think you said 42 books, and I counted three more that you mentioned are in progress while you're talking.
That's right.
Holy cow. All right, I've got some reading to do. This has been Through the Keyhole, live on the Paranormal Radio Network and on UPRN 105.5 FM in New Orleans. I'm your host, Karen Dolan. Thanks so much for listening, everyone. Stay tuned for Angela Joyner and the Joyner Report coming up next, and I will see you next week. Next week, by the way, I'm going to be on an hour early. Just want to be sure to let everyone know I'm broadcasting live from a local psychic fair, the New Moon Psychic Fair here in Rochester. So I'm going to be on 7 to 9 Eastern for next week only. I'll be back to my regular time the following week. Okay, talk to everybody next week. See ya.